Hey, Internet. I think you're recording. I hope so. What's up? This is my second video. My name's Perry. And thanks so much. After my last video, I got so much kind and supportive words from you, both in the comment section and on Tumblr, and I just really, really appreciate that. Like, I didn't realize how important the internet would be for my recovery, and it's been really solid, so thanks everyone. Y'all are so great. And this week is my topic already, and it is, what is sexy consent, and what does that look like for you? And then my bonus question is, what is your favorite femme accessory? Because I love talking about accessories and about being femme and not cis, because those are two awesome things. I just watched Morgan C's video. Morgan's so amazing. I really appreciated your video, Morgan, and your sexy voice, and just everything you said really resonated with me. I think the reason I chose to say sexy consent is because I've had a lot of conversations, especially hooking up with, like, gay guys from Craigslist who are like, oh, you're a trans guy, this is a new experience for me, or, like, not a new experience, but, like, when you want to talk about consent, that sounds really big and scary. And I said sexy consent because I do think talking about consent can be amazing and not scary and super sexy and make everything about a hookup more fulfilling and make it feel just like more real and less nerve-wracking. So for me, I know that I'm like a super verbal person. Like, during sex, I talk a lot. And I always want to talk a little bit before, of course, and establish my boundaries. But I was thinking particularly with this question of one person that I only see every once in a while, and like, we have like a cute sexy relationship, and they're not a super verbal person. Like, verbal cues for them I could tell made them kind of uncomfortable during sex. So I was trying to like navigate being a super verbal person, how we could communicate consent a lot better. So I really like what Morgan said in her video about, you know, establishing boundaries but leaving room for exploration. Because for me, and I think for this person, I can't really speak for them, but what has felt really good in my hookups is like, when I have established boundaries about like what I like and what I don't particularly, but you know, when my whole body is seen as like a sexual, not thing, but like something of desire, instead of just like people just like going to grab for specific areas, which is like sketchy and weird, but like, I think that's how a lot of people learn sex. So it's nice when people just like touch. I think touch and just exploration for me are really things that I feel like you can feel out consent, because I think we learn what we like while we practice them, and we learn what we don't like, well, when it happens. And that is, for most people, and for me, I think, in my experiences, it's always easier to define what we don't like as opposed to what we do like. And especially in terms of my gender, it's always been like, I know I don't want this, and I don't want to be this, but like, what do I want? Ugh, it's a whole other thing. So for me, like, sexy consent is really just like body language and the way we touch and the way we engage with each other's bodies is like more than just like this tedious sort of routine of like, okay, this happens, and then this happens, and then this happens, and then we're done. You know, it's more in depth, and there's more room for engagement in every level, like touch and sound and like, yeah, every level. So verbal check-ins are good for me. Language, like how I want to talk about my body when it does come up, like using specific words for specific parts of my body or not. Yeah, that's felt really good. And also to play the whose cock is who game, that's really fun. I'll leave that to your imagination, but that's one of my favorite games. So that's all I really wanted to say about how I feel about sexy consent. I think I was really interested in hearing everyone else and how everyone interpreted that question. That's really what I like about this channel, like throwing questions out, hearing like multiple answers. In terms of my favorite femme accessory, for me, I'm traveling, so I don't have a lot of my stuff with me. But lately, you know, not buying drugs leaves a lot more room for spending things like on things like chocolate and nail polish and makeup, which are things I really like. I love fake big eyelashes and makeup. And I just bought these two really cute nail polishes. I'm wearing both of them now. I don't know if you can see them based on how my camera will focus. But there's this one. It's Hard as Nails Extreme Wear, and it's called Rockstar Pink. And it's like, it looks like confetti, and it's like pink and blue and gold glitter. And then there's this gold one. I didn't know it would have such a skinny little brush. It's called Instant Artist, so I guess you're supposed to be able to use more detail with it. But it's super cool. It's such a cool color, and I painted the tips of my nails with it, so it looks super, super good together. I love glitter. And then also, I have with me a cherished little necklace that my lovely friend Kiara gave me. And it's a little seahorse, the tiniest little seahorse, in a little plastic encasing. And I love this accessory because whenever I need to feel a little bit grounded, I just look at it and I wonder where this little guy's been all over the world and now around my neck through all my various ridiculous adventures. So that helps. That's helping me out a lot actually lately too, to remain grounded. I'm feeling a lot of anxiety while my brain is healing and figuring out coping mechanisms for anxiety and like shit that I just like haven't dealt with ever. So yeah, I guess that's the end of my video. I'm super stoked. I'm feeling so much better. I'm really glad about everything and all of you watching this. So I hope you have a really good weekend. I love you. Bye.